last week, at the campus of Carnegie Mellon University, I was walking back to my office, and along this route, I needed to cross an intersection. As I'm approaching this intersection, the light turns red. And I also noticed that nearby is an individual who is blind. She has a guide dog with her. I overheard her conversation that they need to hurry up because they're running late. So as all of us got to the intersection, I noticed that the dog just stopped firmly. In a sense, the dog disobeyed its owner. I find it so amazing that guide dogs are trained so well to also know when to disobey their owners. As owners, they want the dog to obey them, but also disobey them, because one of the primary responsibilities of the dog is to be able to keep them safe. So you might be wondering, why is she telling me about guide dogs when the topic is artificial intelligence, or AI? Training a guide dog to understand paradoxes is relevant to training AI systems that support people, because these systems also need to understand paradoxes as well. A really exciting area is designing AI to help older adults age in place, that is, to continue to live in their homes instead of go to a care facility. One of the organizations or areas, workplaces, that does this type of work is the AI Caring Institute, which I'm a part of, that's supported by the National Science Foundation. My colleagues and I are designing a generation of AI systems that are intelligent, interactive, personalized, and ethically driven. These systems are designed to support older adults with various tasks, including cooking, managing finances, medications and exercises, coordinating schedules as well. These systems include robots, smarter versions of Siri and Google Home, chatbots, and virtual agents. And working in this area is really exciting, and it's also challenging at the same time. And what I love the most is that it enables me to leverage different areas of my expertise, including the technical area of algorithms design, social science area of understanding people and relationships, and ethics and fairness. In this talk, I will focus on three main topics. The first one is that AI can better our lives. The second one is our research findings and design implications about people's acceptance of AI, which are paradoxes. And the last is ethical considerations. Now, regarding the first topic of how AI can better our lives, AI is sometimes referred to as bots, which is short for robots. By 2034, it's estimated that there will be more people over the age of 65 than under 18. The aging population will increasingly need care, so the declining number of youth represents a problem. Also, with aging, the chances of experiencing cognitive decline, such as dementia, increases as well, and this makes the problem worse. By 2030, it's estimated that in the US here, we will need an additional 1.2 million caretakers to support people living with dementia. This actually represents the biggest worker gap in the US. So where will these 1.2 million additional care workers come from? A part of the answer is AI. Currently, family members are the ones that are providing the majority of the care for those that are experiencing dementia. They're the ones that are taking on the burden of care that's caused by the rise of dementia. And bots can help absorb some of this burden so that family members and their loved ones can have quality time together instead of manual tasks like tracking medications and organizing schedules, for instance. All right, so we know that bots can support older adults as they age at home. However, this really depends on older adults' acceptance of bot support. So if it's you, would you let a bot enter your home? Would you let a bot enter your parents' homes? And to find the answer to these questions, we seek to under areas of support where people are accepting of bots, where they want bots to help them, and also understand areas where bots should never intervene. In other words, we're trying to understand boundaries of bot acceptance. And trying to understand these boundaries is challenging because some technologies do not exist yet. An example is with driving. So as people age, or older adults age, one of the common questions is to assess whether they should continue driving or not. And driving is really important because driving is a sense of, gives a sense of independence, or it symbolizes independence. I'm gonna share a story about a character named Pat. Pat is 72 years old, she lives alone, and unfortunately, she's experiencing memory decline. She has a son and a daughter, and they live nearby. Last week, Pat and her son were driving, and Pat stopped at a green light. This week, Pat and her son are going to her doctor's appointment. Her son offers to drive, and he suggests that he drives from now on. Pat insists on driving. She told him that she's still good to drive. She also told him that last week, stopping at the green light was a one-time incident. The bot chimes in and shares that Pat actually had two such incidents last week. She veered to the shoulder and almost missed a stop sign. Now imagine that you are Pat. You most likely will value your independence highly. How do you feel about a bot that is tattling on you to your son? Because you might eventually have to move out of your home. Now imagine that you are the son. You love your mom very much, and you want to know how she's doing, especially if her health is declining, so that you know how best to help her. You most likely will be prioritizing her safety over her independence. Now imagine that you are the bot. What would you do in this instance? You see, there are power dynamics at play and also conflicts of interest. Being the bot is actually my job. I'm teaching the bot to be able to reason about complex social situations like this one, to be able to make decisions that are appropriate now and also in the long term. In particular, I'm teaching the bot three things. One is that I'm teaching the bot to be able to decipher people's underlying intents, needs, and desires. I'm also teaching the bot to be able to communicate its own intents and goals to the users. And I'm also teaching the bot to be able to make decisions, to be able to collaborate within this care network of diverse stakeholders, stakeholders that include family members, doctors, and lawyers, for instance, and to be able to collaborate in the long term. So this is one of the situations that we are interested in our research. And in our research, we found really interesting results about people's acceptance of bot support. These are paradoxes that are relating to adoption, keeping up with appearances, and control. Now, regarding adoption, we found that older adults who are healthy are hesitant to accept bot support, because accepting the bot meant that they are also accepting the possibility of future decline, and they didn't want to accept that. We asked them about what they envision their future to be like in the case where they need more help or support. They imagine a bot that has intimate knowledge about them, as if the bot's been with them prior to decline. So you see, this is a paradox, because they're saying, "Bot, right now, I still got it all. I don't need your help. I don't want you to come into my home. But later, if I do need your help, you must know a lot about me so that you can help me as if you've been with me from the very beginning." From a technical development standpoint, the bot would need to be adopted way earlier, years and months, in order for it to provide this type of personalized care. On the other hand, though, for older adults who are experiencing memory problems and their caretakers, they're very willing to accept the bot's support. In terms of appearances, this is referring to how people perceive themselves and how they think others are perceiving them, and also how they want the bot to perceive them and their family members. We saw that with older adults who are healthy, they have a mismatch between their true capabilities and their perceived capabilities, and they do not want to be confronted of their diminished capacities. However, for older adults who are experiencing memory problems and their families, they do want to be confronted of their diminished capacities. They want the bot to alert them and their family members of their decline because they realize that they may not notice their decline. So that's another paradox, where one group is saying, bot, do not confront me in my diminished capacities, and another group is saying, bot, you need to alert me and my family of my decline. Now, the last finding is about control. What I mean by control here is who makes decisions about the older adult and who controls the bot. Older adults who are healthy, they want full control of the bot. They want the bot to be passive, to only do what it's told. Now, for older adults who are experiencing memory problems and their caretakers, they want the bot to assert control on their behalf, to advocate for them. They want the bot to be active, to be in the forefront. They realize that as their health declines, that their ability to advocate for themselves may also diminish. So that's the last paradox, is one group is saying, bot, I want to control you. Another group is saying, bot, I want you to assert control on my behalf. What do all these findings mean in terms of design implications? For adoption, we recommend that bots be adopted way earlier in people's life stages, before they even consider themselves as an older adult. And bots should not be marketed as an aid for cognitive decline, or else this would just invoke dread and anxiety. It's better to market bots as a productivity aid that helps with families with coordinating activities and schedules, and then later on, if a family member experiences cognitive decline, the bot can transition to help that person and to serve more of a social role. In terms of keeping up appearances, bots will have to initially start with operating in a space of mismatched capabilities and reason about when to acknowledge that mismatch. And when to acknowledge a mismatch may be dependent on the bot's affiliation, that is, who the bot works for. For instance, if the bot works for the healthy older adult, the bot may just need to pretend that everything's okay and don't acknowledge any mismatch. However, if the bot works for the caregivers, the bot will have to let them know of the mismatch capabilities and decline. Now, in terms of control, this is who controls the bot. Healthy older adults want to control the bot, and those that are experiencing memory problems want the bot to assert control on their behalf. This is similar to conflicts with parents and teen, but only running in the opposite direction. Parents want to parent, but they also want to teach their teens responsibility. Teens, on the other hand, want independence, but they also want to be cared for when they make poor choices. And for some of us here, we may experience this role reversal where the parent becomes a child and the child becomes a parent. And in this phases of change is probably where the bot will have to increasingly assert control, but do so in a manner that's respectful. An example is, at the beginning, the bot will work for the older adult who's healthy. But as that person's health declines and they cede power to their caregivers, the bot then transitions to work for the caregivers, but still advocating for the older adult. A fundamental question is, should a bot even be an advocate in the very first place? If yes, there are three things that we'll want the bot to consider. When we think of someone advocating for us or interceding for us, we expect them to have our best interests in mind. So how do we mathematically represent best interests in numbers so that bots can understand, because this is a social construct? The second thing is, what kind of characteristic traits would bot need to exhibit so that people would listen to it as an advocate? And lastly, what does a bot need to know so that it can effectively advocate? Bots also need to consider ethics to minimize unintended harm. And this includes recognizing and avoiding behavior that is related to exploitation, domination, deception, and unjustified paternalism. An example is that a bot would need to be able to detect when an older adult is being taken advantage of financially by their family members or other people, and be able to take actions that are appropriate. In some cases, paternalism may be justified. For instance, consider the scenario of an older adult who is prone to wandering and getting lost and also has memory impairment. The bot may take on the persona of a loved one by using their voice to distract this person so that they don't go out and get lost. So overall, designing bots to support older adults is challenging because these systems need to be robust ethically and be able to understand paradoxes. But I'm very hopeful and I'm also very excited for a future where bots can help provide a home for our loved ones that gives them the gifts of independence, time, and continued life purpose.